going to start with the central nervous system. This is a mid-sagittal section of the brain. So right here you have the forebrain, which is consisted of the telencephalon and the diencephalon. And then you've got the midbrain right here and the hindbrain down there. All right, so the central nervous system, it consists of the brain and the spinal cord. So here's the spinal cord going down right there along with the brain. The major regions of the adult brain are in the cerebrum, the brainstem, and the cerebellum. The cerebrum is this upper part right here. Then you've got the brainstem, which is down here, and the cerebellum is over here. The surface features, bumps. So right here, the gyrus is the singular form, and then gyri is plural. So you've got, that is a bump right there. And then a sulcus is the groove. So right in between would be a sulcus, and then the bump would be the gyrus. And then the CNS is covered by meninges. So that is a surface around the whole brain that protects it. All right, so the telencephalon, the cerebrum is what the telencephalon turns into in the adult brain. The cerebrum is the largest portion of the brain, and it's responsible for higher brain functions. And the telencephalon has five lobes, so you've got the frontal, the parietal. So here, the frontal is right here in this peach color. The parietal lobe is right here in the blue. Then you've got the temporal lobe, which is right here in pink. The occipital lobe back here in green. And then the insula is deep within the lateral sulcus, so the lateral sulcus is right here, and that is linked to emotion and the regulation of the body's homeostasis. All right, so talking more about the frontal lobe, we've got, so the precentral gyri are involved in the motor control. So right here you have the central sulcus, so any precentral gyri is going to be in front of that, so up here, and then in the later slide, we'll talk about postcentral gyri, and that would be anything back here behind the central sulcus. And then, basically, this diagram is just explaining that the body regions with the greatest motor innervation occupy the largest areas of motor cortex. So it kind of makes sense if you think about it, like the fingers and the thumb and the hand take up a large portion, as well as the facial expression, because those areas require more motor skills, you know, if you think about your facial expressions, your smiling, whatever, and then, you know, your senses in your hand, whereas something like the lower leg is a smaller chunk of that. All right, this is kind of an interesting picture, the frontal lobe and personality. So this is the school of Phineas Gage, and he was a railway foreman. This is from 1848. So here's a picture of it going through the school. And this is kind of how we discovered that the frontal lobe had to do with personality, because when a tamping rod went through his frontal lobe, it affected his personality. So before the accident, he was likable and very friendly, and after the accident, he became irritable and mean. So that was how we first connected that. Next, we're going to talk about the parietal lobe. So like I was saying before, the postcentral gyri are behind that, and the postcentral, they're responsible for perception of the somatostatic sensation. So this is the same kind of chart as before with kind of the areas that require more. So you can see on here the genitals, the foot, toes, lower leg, and then they're all kind of spaced out based off of how much sensory areas they require. And again, it's explaining that the body regions with the highest densities of receptors occupy the largest areas of sensory cortex, which makes sense. So this is an MRI of sensory cortex. MRI stands for magnetic resonance imaging, and how an MRI works is the protons respond to a magnetic field that gives you the picture. And then there's also an electrocephalogram, that's also abbreviated EEG, and that measures the synaptic potential with electrical currents. So right here, this diagram is showing if you were to stimulate your index finger, this is the part of the brain that would be stimulated, and so on. So you've got the circle, there's the circle that would be stimulated in the brain. All right, the temporal and occipital lobes. The temporal lobe deals with the interpretation of auditory centers that receives sensory fibers from the cochlea, which is the inner ear. And this is the same diagram that we had earlier, just showing all the different areas. And it also deals with the interpretation and association of auditory and visual information. And then with the occipital lobe, it's the primary area responsible for vision and coordination of eye movements. All right, moving on to the diencephalon. So the diencephalon becomes these things in the adult brain. So you you've got the thalamus, the hypothalamus, the pituitary gland, and the pineal gland. And here's a little diagram of like all the different portions. You've got the telencephalon up here, the diencephalon, the diencephalon, mesencephalon, and myelencephalon down at the bottom. So we're looking right here at the diencephalon. All right, so talking about the thalamus a little bit. The thalamus is what composes the majority of the diencephalon. So that's right here, you can see in the diagram. It acts as a relay center, so you just have to remember that the thalamus is the relay center for all of the sensory information to the cerebrum. And then the lateral geniculate nuclei relay visual information, whereas the medial geniculate nuclei relay auditory information. Then right here we've got the midbrain. The midbrain contains the corpora quadrumina, the cerebral peduncles, the substantia nigra, and the red nucleus. So there's a diagram of that. And then the functions of the midbrain, it works with your visual reflexes, it's a relay center for auditory information, and it deals with motor coordination, degeneration of the axon fibers from substantia nigra causes Parkinson's disease. So, and then moving on, we've got the hindbrain. The hindbrain is right in this area, the colored part, and that consists of the metencephalon, which has the pons and the cerebellum. Pons contain respiratory centers, and the cerebellum receives input from proprioceptors, and it deals with the coordination of movements. And then the myelencephalon is the medulla. So all descending and ascending fiber tracts between the spinal cord and the brain must pass through the medulla. And it's also the cardiac control center. It regulates autonomic nerve control of the heart, and it regulates respiration with the pons. There's a better picture of it right here. So you've got this is the midbrain, you've got the pons right here, and then here's the medulla oblongata down toward the bottom. So this is just saying again, the mesencephalon is the pons and cerebellum, and then the myelencephalon is the medulla. So, okay, ascending spinal tracts. This is a diagram of basically how the tracts carry sensory information. And they carry the information from cutaneous receptors, proprioceptors, and visual receptors to the cerebral cortex. And then here's the diagram of the descending spinal tracts. The pyramidal tracts descend directly without synaptic interruption from the cerebral cortex to the spinal cord, and they deal with the fine motor movements. And then the reticulospinal tracts deal with the gross motor movement. So that's just showing how it, from the descending tract, how the signals move. And then we've got cerebral lateralization. That is the specialization of one hemisphere of the brain. So the left hemisphere is more adept to language and analytical abilities. And then the right hemisphere is limited to verbal ability and is most adept at visual and spatial tasks. So right here you've got olfaction, speech and writing, it's your main language center, calculation, yada yada. Then you've got simple language comprehension and spatial concepts. So like your right hemisphere would deal with, say you're pulling into a parking spot, seeing how close you are to other cars, when you're gonna hit the bumper, all that stuff. All right, language and aphasia. So we've got Broca's area involves your articulation of speech. Broca's area is right here in blue. And then after damage to Broca's area, the comprehension of speech is unimpaired. You can understand a sentence, but you can't repeat it to someone else. And then with Wernicke's area, it involves language comprehension. So if you damage your Wernicke's area, your language comprehension is destroyed, but you can still speak. Your speech is rapid, but it really has no meaning. And that is right here in the pink, or maybe purple. All right, then we've got neurons and electrical signaling. That's just kind of the outline of what we're going to talk about. So the nervous system, like we already said, the central nervous system consists of the brain and the spinal cord, and then the peripheral nervous system consists of your cranial nerves and your spinal nerves. And there's two types of cells in the nervous system, and that is your neurons and your supporting cells. The supporting cells are the neuroglia and glial cells. Your neurons, they are the structural and functional units of the nervous system. They respond to physical and chemical stimuli. They produce and conduct electrical impulses throughout the body, and they release chemical transmitters, which is how the impulse is sent. The structure of a neuron, you can see right here, so you've got the cell body. It contains the nucleus, so the nucleus is right here, the orange, and it provides a receptive area. And then you've got the dendrites, which are the little hands coming off of the cell body, and they also provide a receptive area, and they conduct electrical activity. activity toward the cell body. And then the axon is right here, and that's, you can remember axon, it carries impulses away from the body, ANA. So this is how the impulses get sent away. Then the classification of neurons, we've got functional neurons and structural neurons. So functional is what do the neurons do, and the structural is what do they look like. And that is all for that one. Thank you.